There we go. Thank you. Wait for the soft jazz to die down. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this Onward Fringe on housing, on why we need to unlock housing supply and why doing it might boost the economy. My name's Adam Hawksbee. I'm Deputy Director at Onward. And look, this is a topic we were chatting just before where there seems to be very well kind of populated fringe meetings on housing, comments that are made by ministers, well beyond the housing minister, about why building more homes is hugely important, not just to grow the economy, but also to tackle the massive intergenerational unfairness that there is at the moment, where a huge number of young people cannot get access to capital, cannot get on the housing ladder, are struggling to relocate to areas where they might want to move to opportunity. It's always quite worrying when there's violent agreement in public, but yet something doesn't quite seem to be shifting, right? And I think everyone would recognise that there is a lot of work yet to do on how we can unlock housing supply across the economy. So in this discussion, we're going to talk a bit about why unlocking housing matters, probably just beyond housing as an asset, why it's important for our economy overall, and crucially how we do that. And I'm keen that we kind of have quite a specific and heated debate about how we get that stuff done. And I'm delighted to be joined by a really good panel to have that discussion. So let me quickly introduce them. We have on my immediate right, Lee Rowley, who's the Minister for Local Government and Building Safety. So he's not the Housing Minister. So there may well be moments when he'll have to defer to his colleague, Rachel. But crucially, he's been doing a huge amount of work within the Department for Levelling Up on how we can accelerate infrastructure more broadly. And so we'll be able to speak a little bit about how the government are thinking about bringing forward some of the really crucial infrastructure projects that housing relies on. We know that a lot of housing is often blocked or communities are opposed to it because the underpinning infrastructure isn't there, or at least they don't believe it will be there. To Lee's right, we have Jennie Daly, the Chief Executive of Taylor Wimpey, one of Britain's biggest house builders. Britain's biggest house builder?
Not quite.
Not quite, okay. One of Britain's biggest house builders. To my immediate left, we have Sam Richards, the director of the campaigning group Britain Remade. You've been doing fantastic work making the case for infrastructure projects, including major housing projects across the UK. And then to my far left, we have Stephen Bush, associate editor at the Financial Times, someone who's written a lot about this topic, and in particular about why it matters so much politically that parties get this right, or at the very least have a compelling offer on this. We're going to have some opening remarks from the panel. We're then going to turn to you guys for questions. I'll ask all speakers to speak kind of very close into the mic, both because when it rains in here, it feels a little bit like the fabric roof might go, and also because Steve Bray might try and chip into the conversation at some points, and that can get a little bit loud. So please do speak directly into the mics, and if everyone wants to tweet, we're using the hashtag for the conference, hashtag CPC23. Lee, let me turn to you. Why is kind of increasing housing supply important, and what are some of the ways the government's trying to do it?
Sure. Well, thank you, Adam, and thank you very much for the invitation. Good to see everybody. Before I get drowned out by the rain, obviously the cornerstone of conservatism is people being able to gain capital and then being able to make decisions about what they want to do with their lives. One of the best ways to do that is to make people homeowners, and it is at the core of what we've tried to do for the best part of 50 years and beyond to try and ensure that that happens. The question then becomes where we go next, in a more challenging place, but also in a place where we've built the best part of 2 million houses in the past 13 years, built more than Blair and Brown managed to build in their 13 years, where we've got home ownership rates ticking up, to a small extent, but they are going up to a certain extent. And we've got the highest number of first-time buyers recently in a couple of decades. So it's important that we have context, but I think everybody would recognise, including myself on this panel, that there is a challenge and we have to try and work through that challenge. And my boss, Michael, who is speaking in the hall in a moment and so is not able to be here, gave a speech in July, and I'm going to shamelessly pull a few points out of it to help influence this discussion when we get going. He's very clear there are a clear set of areas where there is particular demand, and there are obvious places in which you can try to resolve some of these issues. It's always talked about, I used to be a London councillor before I went home to Derbyshire, but you can significantly enhance the densification of cities. That is one of the key areas which Michael set out in July. My old ward, Maida Vale, if you had the same densification as Maida Vale in just 5% of the rest of the built-up part of London, you would have over a million more homes. And Maida Vale does not feel overly exposed or overly dense. It is the way that you build properties and the way that you build communities around those properties which matters. Obviously, development within urban areas, development of brownfield land, comes with additional complexities. I don't want to suggest that that isn't the case, but that is one of the major focus of areas that we're looking at in the coming years ahead. Equally, there's been a clear emphasis on places like Cambridge, where there is a golden halo, whatever you want to call it, of where there is significant job growth, where there is a significant skills base, where there is a clear USP, unique selling point, which we all want to enhance, and part of that will be growing the housing around that. So there's a lot of work going on within the department from which Rachel, the housing minister, my colleague, and Michael are leading. For my own personal part in this, is twofold. One, a sort of hygiene factor, albeit a hugely important one, that we have a challenge with the quality of our housing in certain parts at the moment, and so there is work to do there, specifically in which I cover, which is the building safety brief, a hugely important brief which has come from the tragic events that happened in Grenfell, and there is a huge amount of work going on to make sure that the problems that were made visible as a result of Grenfell need to be resolved, and we need to work through that as quickly as possible, and there is capacity going into that, extensive capacity going into that, to make sure that the properties which need to be made safe are done so. But also the other part of my portfolio is on major infrastructure projects, often the things which go around housing, or as Adam indicates, give consent with small political consent, community consent, for the kind of things that you need to do on housing, and we need to put housing in the right place and do it with the greatest community consent that we can, and we're trying to work on speeding up the process of large infrastructure projects. There's a process called Nationally Significant Infrastructure Projects that is for very large, very important, big ticket projects which the whole of the country would benefit from, and it is absolutely fair to say that the amount of time it takes to get through the NSIP process at the moment, it's the kind of large solar farms, large offshore wind, large transport projects, has slowed down. It was about 2.5 years to get through the development consent orders, which is the technical order which you need in order to progress. It's about 2.5 years, 10 years ago, it's now above 4 years, and so we've come out with a cross-governmental action plan to try and resolve that. Now, it's always dangerous to talk about government working together, but we are genuinely trying to work together. We are genuinely trying to make that action plan work. I have very regular meetings with 4 different colleagues from other parts of government, and we are absolutely focused on finding the specific interventions to reduce the amount of time it takes to deliver large infrastructure. Because if we're going to do large infrastructure, if we're going to build the roads, if we're going to build the rail, we need to make sure that that's done in a way which works, it's done as quickly as possible, and it's done as cost effectively as possible. Major way in which you can do that is make sure that planning works. So there's a huge amount of work going on, both specifically on planning within the department, but then also more broadly to try and make sure the planning sector gets into a place where it works, not just for housing, but also for the infrastructure which goes around it.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Lee. Jennie, let's come to you next, if that's okay. You've heard from the Minister a sense of how it's supposed to work and some of the actions that are happening. How does it feel from a house builder's perspective, from a private sector perspective?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you very much, Adam. And, I'd like to recognise some of the really great work that Onward is doing in respect of challenges in the housing sector and the wider built environment. I'm always pleased to be on a panel when someone else mentions planning before I do. So thank you for that, Minister. The proposition today is about unlocking housing supply and how it can boost the economy. And I think it's no secret, particularly to many faces that I recognise in the room, that housing is in crisis. Overall housing delivery, the shortage of affordable homes, rising house prices, and the like. However, in the debate around the status quo and protectionism, we do often overlook the actual economic impact, economic positives, and the multiplier effect of housing in our economy, and the role it plays in stimulating broader economic growth, not just housing for the housing sake element, albeit extremely important. The construction sector itself is a very significant contributor to the UK economy, providing jobs, creating wealth and economic activity. But the lack of housing is affecting the construction industry and, as I say, the wider economy. So unlocking housing can create jobs, it can stimulate economic growth, but most importantly, it can improve the quality of life for millions of people. The construction industry relies, I think, on a very vast network of suppliers and contractors. It has a phenomenal multiplier effect across the economy, and as I say, leads to many sort of investments in jobs, goods and services. But fundamentally, unlocking housing supply will improve that standard of living. As a business, we employ directly 5,000 people, considerably more right across the supply chain. That's spread right across the UK And you know, we work alongside lots of local businesses and their supply chains, and we're in favour of policies that promote development, obviously, right across the UK. And I do note, you know, the ministerial, you know, comments around Cambridge densification in London, but actually our housing need is right across the country, unlocking the economy. There are demands right across the country, and I think that we also have to look after our regions. You know, the principles of levelling up beyond London and some of those, you know, economic accelerator areas, absolutely, but we can't stop there. There's so much more that needs to be done. So for me, improving the planning system to ensure that we can deliver the housing that is required and the boost to the economy, the contribution into UK GDP that housing and its supply chain can make, I think, are fundamental. And you know what, I do like stats, Adam. So, you know, a few that I think are just worth calling out to set the scale for those who may not be aware of the contribution of housing in and of itself to our economy. So if we look at 2020-2021 financial year, the sector delivered 233,000 homes. We employed over 800,000 people, and we contributed about £40 billion worth of activity to our economy. So these are big, big numbers that we're referring to. So, you know, planning, the challenges across planning reform and the strategic system, shortages of resources in local authorities are all, for me, things that government really needs to turn its attention to, both in the short term and the long term.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Stephen, let's turn to you. I mean, the Lib Dem conference last week ended up being, if not dominated, certainly the debate about housing became a big part of that. It's clearly been a big discussion here at the Tories. Why does this topic keep rising to the top of the political agenda, and does it mean that progress is actually going to be made?
Well, I suppose the optimistic argument is, and the reason why it's now at the top of the agenda, is it is so closely linked with actually all of the political parties' different problems. Like every argument you are having among yourselves this week, you know, whether it's high speed to the lack of headroom for tax cuts, right, it does, you know, there's not a separate ball of planning problems that exist than delay and threaten the property owning democracy. That is also linked to why high speed 2 is as the cut has run beyond cost, and it's also linked to why there are unlikely to be any action on tax cuts anytime soon. For the Liberal Democrats, of course, the reason why they're so divided by it is, on the one hand, the voters who are pushed from the Conservative column to the Liberal Democrat column are pushed that way because they have high housing costs, and so some people in that party would like them to do something about it. And on the other hand, the other group of voters who get pushed from the Conservative column to the Liberal Democrat column are people who don't like new housing starts, and some of them would like to continue to be opportunistic about that. And then if you're the Labour Party and you'd like more money to spend on public services, you know that you've got to, you know, you've ultimately got to create wealth in order to redistribute it. So that again leads them back to some action on planning. But I suppose the note of pessimism I would strike is, look, on my way back from Liberal Democrat conference, because the trains were in a state, George Parker, our political editor, very kindly gave me a lift in his car, and you drive back through the Newbury bypass, which obviously the Thatcher and Major government did quite literally destroy a bunch of ancient woodland in order to build that bypass. If you think about the various, you know, the kind of the tunnels and the various other mitigations for high speed too, this Conservative government is some way from that level of political courage to build something. And as we've seen with Labour's retreat on nutrient neutrality, because they're scared that the Greens will do to them what the Liberal Democrats keep doing to the Conservative Party, right? Like, so we're clearly some way away from the political courage in both parties required to actually do something about this problem, as opposed to talking about it. But nonetheless, I'm optimistic, because talking about something is the first step towards doing something.
And do you think it matters? So is this something where we need to see more of an offer from the parties, or actually are there other topics they should be focusing on?
No, I think it absolutely matters, partly because, although, yeah, in terms of issue salience, very few people are going to vote for a political party because of their offer on housing. Literally everything else that the political parties want to do is being held up and constrained by this issue, right? Like, essentially, it's our productivity problems, it's our skill shortages, it's our construction. Like, unlocking this problem is key to, yeah, it does sometimes feel like every political party would like to go back to be able to have 90s debates about whether or not to have tax cuts or more public spending. And if guys, if you want to get back to that, you've got to fix this problem first.
There you go. And I guess into that challenge steps Britain Remade, right? So, Sam, you guys launched this campaign, what, a year or so ago, trying to help build that political courage, I guess. I mean, why is this such an important issue for you, and what have you found in your work since you launched?
Yeah, that's right. So we launched about a year ago and focused first on energy and speeding up the building of new sources of clean power, new grid connections, some of the work that Lee's doing. Then we've looked at the cost of transport infrastructure, and now we're coming onto the work on housing. And I want to start by saying something that is potentially slightly banal, but is really important, and that is supply and demand is real, folks, and it does apply to the housing market. And we see this right across the developed world, right? It's the case in London, it's the case in Manchester, but it's also the case in Dublin, in Auckland, in Vancouver, in Rome, in Hong Kong, that where demand is high and supply is constrained, the price of housing rises. This is a particularly acute problem in England. It's a particularly acute problem for us. Why? Because we have underbuilt over decades. England currently builds around 220,000 to 240,000 homes a year, and this is the highest rate that we've done in decades. France builds around 380,000 a year, and that's actually declined from a recent peak of about 500,000. Japan currently builds 860,000 homes a year, even though their population is shrinking. And it's no coincidence that they do not have a housing crisis in Tokyo. So what's behind our failure to build? There are two things. One, we've put explicit bans on building across vast chunks of the country with green belts, particularly those areas that surround actually our most productive cities, undermining economic growth. And then secondly, the land that you can build on, the planning process is Byzantine and discretionary. So what happens off the back of that is housing isn't built and it becomes more expensive. What then is the knock-on effect of this for our economy? Obviously, the immediate impact is we all have less money because we have to spend more money on putting a roof over our head. That's the immediate, obvious impact. But there are lots of spillover effects, similar to what Jennie was talking about the spillover effects into the economy. So when you've got scarce housing in high productivity areas, some people are priced out from going to work at the best jobs. Firms can't hire the best people because they can't afford to live in the best areas. At the same time, we know that cities are the main drivers of innovation. That's why I have to say it was slightly depressing to hear the Prime Minister say this week that we're going to move away from cities. Of course, we need to help towns across the country. But cities have, throughout human history, from Venice to Amsterdam to London, been the drivers, to the Bay Area now, in San Francisco, been the drivers of innovation. When people come together, when brilliant minds all merge in one place, they do amazing things. And the high cost of housing that we have now is preventing those connections from being formed. And there are many other factors that flow, many other problems that flow from high housing costs that I'm sure we'll talk about in the conversation. Our lower density cities are worse for climate change. Arguably, they even lead to more obesity as people walk less. But we can talk about more of that stuff. But what do we do about this then? I mean, obviously, there's sort of big picture planning reform has been tried and has been failed on multiple occasions over since the introduction of the Town and Country Planning Act, which is the cause of so many of our woes. But I think that there are some targeted interventions. I think the work on street votes is so critical, which sort of changes the incentives and allows people to vote to both make themselves richer and also to unlock more housing. And then one of the things that at Britain Remade we're going to do a piece of work on is around estate regeneration, which I think you were talking to, Lee. I think our housing estates in London in particular are incredibly low density. And there's a real opportunity to increase the density of those estates, improve the upgrade the homes that are there, but also add new homes, adding to the housing stock. And actually, since the rules changed in 2018, that allowed residents to vote on new schemes, there have been 31 ballots on 30 schemes for estate regeneration, and 29 out of the 30 have been won first time by huge majorities. So there is real support for this, and it makes sense. People get to upgrade their own home. They get to live in a nicer place. They get to live in a nicer development. But also it's good for the community and the overall supply of housing. So that, I think, is a potential way through. But to come back to the original point, it cannot be understated just how central the housing supply crisis is to our current economic challenges. And Onward have been doing fantastic work on this. The CPS have done a lot of really good work on this. But I would really recommend, if I'm sure many of you will already have read this, but for me the definitive piece on this is The Housing Theory of Everything by Sam Bowman, John Byers and Ben Southwood is really worth a read.
I'll allow some other think tank work to be promoting on my platform if it's that good. It is a very, very good paper. Do read it. Come to questions to the audience. But Lee, I want to ask you first about this cities and towns question. Onward were delighted with the long-term plan for towns announced on Sunday, 1.1 billion, 55 places, 20 million endowment. That's really serious money, particularly if it goes through to local community towns as opposed to getting caught up in kind of intermediate bureaucracy. But some of the language around it, as Sam said, kind of troubled some folks that were keen for a similarly big, ambitious plan for cities. You know, you can do both. So how do you think about this trade-off, or is there one, between cities and towns?
Well, maybe I'm about to say something that politicians always say, but I mean, I don't see it as an either-or. It obviously has to be an and. It has to be an and. We have to... You know, Conservatives are at their best when they're taking everybody along with them, irrespective of where they work, irrespective of where they live, who they are, where they come from. So there's a principal point behind that. But equally, if you... And I say this as somebody who represents a town, which I'll come to in a moment, or a set of towns. I think if you look at what we're doing across the country, both in terms of the things which Michael has announced in terms of what he wants to do in terms of densification of cities, the devolution of powers to major moralities, the work that is being done alongside Andy Street in Birmingham and Andy Burnham, not obviously of our manor, but significant amounts of money and support and flexibility and power to be able to make a difference in Greater Manchester, and similarly with Andy Street in Birmingham. I think you can see a clear and obvious narrative and activity around making sure that we're supporting the cities outside London and London itself. As a Member of Parliament who comes from a town who represents 4.5 smaller towns in Derbyshire, I would just say it is hugely, hugely, hugely important, and particularly for areas like mine, who have not spoken as loudly as they probably should have done over the past 40 or 50 years. There is a general sense that they have not been in the conversation as much as they need to. They have not been set as central to the discussion as they should have been, and they've been overlooked by governments in the past. And it is vital, if we believe in that view of conservatism, wanting to bring everybody along with us, that we do pay special attention to towns around the country, given the place where they've come from. But that does not have to be at the expense of the work we're doing in cities.
Brilliant. Thank you, Lee. So let's come to some questions from the audience. That was a very quick shooting of hands. If when you ask a question, you could just say your name and the organisation you're from, that would be great. Let's take one from the very front here, one from just over here, and then one at the back there. And then we'll come and do another round in just a moment, okay? So let's start with one at the front here. We'll have a microphone somewhere. There we are. We'll get you soon, sir. Yeah, just there.
Thanks very much. Mike Leonard from the Building Alliance. On Sunday at this conference, the NHBC reported that house starts were down by 42%. That has massive consequences for... the wider industry as well, not just the lack of supply of new housing, which we desperately need, but the supply chain, manufacturers, closing factories, bricklayers with no work to do, you know, losing the skills that we're going to need for the future. My question's to Lee. Lee, will you lobby the Chancellor to, in the autumn statement, announce plans to get Britain building again? Thank you.
You might say that's Rachel's job. Let's come to the other question in the front there. yeah, next one here. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. My name is Melissa Lawford. I'm from The Telegraph. I had a question for Jennie. I talk to people, developers and people who work in planning, and they have brought up repeatedly that there's been an increase in the kind of politicisation of the planning process. They say more people complain about developments than before, and that that is a key factor in obstructing getting projects approved and across the line. To what extent have you seen an increase in that sense? Does it, is it a problem for you? And do you think that the government should change the planning system so people who complain about developments in their area have less power?
Very good. And then there was a third question just back there.
Hi there. Rika Wojtylewicz, National Federation of Builders and House Builders Association. We predominantly represent SME house builders. On that last question, yes. What I'd like to say is we've spent a lot of time trying to reframe the conversation, and I'm not going to necessarily talk about house building today. It's something actually that Lee mentioned. We need to talk about, we used to talk about organic growth. Gavin Bower liked it, other people didn't. But placemaking and land use may be the good way to get more homes built. And I look at this as a Brummie. Derbyshire was really important to the component trades for the automotive sector. So were the general Midland regions. So perhaps if we talk about the towns, the places, and we reframe it so it's about better land use and better places, that may allow us to get more homes built because there's a buy-in from the local community. And it means that it's not always a competition between house builders and the rest. So is that something that we should be moving towards to try and take the pressure off a solely house building issue?
Excellent, thank you. Okay, so three questions there. One on the fact that housing starts are down, do we need to be lobbying the Treasury? Another on the politicisation of planning, and a third on how we frame this conversation about building. Jennie, let me come to you first on Melissa's question about the politicisation of planning. How much of a problem is that? Has it significantly changed in recent years? And what needs to happen to address it?
Yeah, I think my starting point would be planning has always been politicised, you know, since the Town and Country Planning Act. And, you know, we do live in a democracy, and therefore, you know, even I, who would like to see more development happen, it's important that we do listen to sort of local communities, and that their local politicians are seen to be representing the interests of, you know, of their electorate. I do think, though, stepping back and setting aside the politicised element of it is why, you know, why are more people objecting? Why, you know, why do we seem to have this very negative voice around housing? And that's something that, you know, I think about a lot. And, you know, Lee talked about infrastructure and the timely delivery of infrastructure and the quality of infrastructure that we have, you know, in many of our communities. And that for me is actually the catalyst for the tension in the majority of instances. You know, the lack of school availability, highway congestion, you know, lack of ability to get on a GP, you know, list. Those are the things that really drive communities to object to development. And then you add in the fact that it has become so complex. The last 30 years of planning legislation, European legislation, increased regulations, you know, there's almost every ology, ecology, you know, archaeology, highway impact assessments, health impact assessments, environmental impact assessments of every flora and fauna that you can name. And the planning department are then trying to effectively play referee to a community who can always find something that isn't quite perfect, because development's not perfect. But if we wait for perfection, then we'll have absolutely nothing. So it's both the complexity and I think the tension that we see in our communities around the absence of resources, and we really do need to look at that. So, you know, I'm a big believer in the timely delivery of infrastructure, that when, you know, communities believe that the supporting infrastructure for new development, or actually making up much of the existing deficit, which is a big conversation, then that can help to ease development through. And on reframing the conversation, look, you know, I am a planner by training. So, you know, placemaking, land use efficiency, we are here, you know, as a collective to ensure that we are, you know, using our land resource in a way that is not just sustainable today, but sustainable for future generations. And this is where, you know, housing becomes so emotional, because we're not looking for looking after our younger generation's interests. We're looking after our own in the immediate, you know, the immediate time frame. You know, design has a place and is part of the context. Densification has a place. But none of these are silver bullets. None of these will solve the problem. We need a little bit of everything. You know, so I would encourage, you know, the more that we can engage and we can keep our, you know, local politicians and communities talking, as opposed to using absolute guillotine approaches. And for me, talking up the positives, housing can deliver many benefits, you know, social cohesion, social mobility, economic growth, better health outcomes, better education outcomes. For me, let's raise the positive and, yeah, I'll try and mitigate the negative.
Stephen, can I come to you on this question of the politicisation of the process? I mean, it feels like kind of NIMBYism, or certainly discussions of it, are a bigger part of our politics now than they were a few years ago. Is that the case? Is the kind of NIMBY lobby bigger, louder, more influential?
Yes and no. I mean, the central problem is that we have a planning system which encourages people to treat qualitative information like it's quantitative, right? The consultation process is great for raising objections and things to think about, but it doesn't, and quite deliberately does not, reflect the majority opinion of a community. That's not what it's seeking to do, but it is increasingly treated as if these two things are analogous. Look, I'm afraid I do think a lot of this is about an absence of political courage and willingness to upset people. And some of the stuff about reframing, look, it works a bit at the margin, but, you know, when you think about, well, I think about the new development in, you know, the parts of London where I live and have grown up, where it's absolutely internalized all of the really good work that creates streets and the beautiful buildings, and there's a lot of really good urbanism now that, you know, we're talking about tower blocks and look really pretty, have got great lighting, great street level stuff. People still object to them at the beginning of the process. Now, I strongly believe that in 20 years' time, those developments that have benefited from the work in the Beautiful Buildings Commission and from that really good urbanism will be nicer places to live, and we will look back at that as good public and social policy. But in terms of these political objections to planning, I don't think any of this stuff really fixes that. What fixes that is the willingness to essentially say, okay, well, we've had the consultation, we've heard some objections that we know aren't representative, we think some of them are useful, so we're acting on them, but we actually are just going to ignore quite a lot of them. And you just do have to be willing to go through that pain barrier, as opposed to this kind of, oh, well, if we wait long enough, eventually there'll be some platonic form of planning, which means everyone likes developments when they're midway through, which we know is not the case.
Platonic form of planning could definitely be a future Onward paper. I'll try and get that written. Sam, let me come to you. One of the really interesting parts of your methodology and what you've done is kind of focus groups and discussions around the country with people to understand why they might be opposed to or reasons they might be in favour of infrastructure projects. This question about framing, do you think that is important, the way we talk about this matters, or actually is it much more raw and material and the framing's a bit irrelevant?
I think the framing is important, but I agree with Stephen's point that fundamentally it works at the margins, and what you really need to change are incentives. It's sometimes the case that the benefits for infrastructure projects or for new homes will be either too diffuse or will be to future residents rather than the people who are there now. And that's why something like street votes works, to flip those incentives to make it work for the people who are there. But
I want to quickly explain street votes, people that might not know street votes.
Yeah, sure. So think of a street in like Pinner, somewhere in northwest London, where at the moment there's a bunch of bungalows. under street votes, the people on that street will be able to have a vote and decide if they want to add stories to their property. In so doing, they would obviously make themselves multimillionaires, but would also be able to add vast amounts to the housing, or significant amount, to the housing supply. So it's a way of adding more democracy, but also unlocking supply by changing the incentives. I think that really, as much as the narrative is really important, is key. But I would say, just to sound a slight note of caution on this, as I say, we've worked on three main areas: energy, transport, and housing. On energy, people fundamentally buy the relationship between building new sources of clean power here in Britain and us becoming energy independent, and are supportive of building more onshore wind farms and more nuclear power plants here in this country. On transport, again, there is a greater understanding that, yes, if you build the, you know, the Lower Thames Crossing, it's going to make my journey easier. If you dual the A1 for, around Morpeth, it's going to speed things up. The reason I opened with supply and demand is real on housing is that, unfortunately, in most of the groups that we talk to, people fundamentally don't buy it. And I think that is a result of the fact that we've allowed our housing crisis to escalate to such an extent that when new homes are built, they are already unaffordable for so many families. And so people have a very understandable sense that, well, kind of what's the point? You're just building, in people often say, executive homes, or, you know, homes that are already out of reach because we have let it get that far. But the only way we're going to get back is by building. That's the only way we're going to catch up.
Brilliant. Thank you, Sam. Lee, let me come to you. Obviously, a few questions there, but in particular, this first one from Mike from the Building Alliance on the fact that housing starts are down pretty dramatically. Is there kind of urgent action that needs to be taken, things kind of later this year, autumn statement, or actually the kind of more medium-term measures that you outline the way forward?
Well, obviously, we don't want house building to go down. We all expected that there would be a challenge around the economic situation that we're in and about the movement towards a more normal, in historical terms, rate of interest rates that are out there, which is what we've seen in the past couple of years or so, 18 months or so. The government is spending a significant amount of taxpayers' money on subsidising house building. There's the best part of £12 billion out there over the next few years for affordable housing programmes, for example. So it's not that there isn't a substantial amount. And of course, the department will always make the case for all of the areas which it has purview over to try and win the best settlements that it can in order to meet the objectives. But, and I say this gently and not specifically yourself, but every time I'm asked for some more money, I always say, great, can you tell me what you want us to spend less on? Because that's the conversation which is often missing from this discussion. We're overspending by £130 billion a year as a country, just spent 400 and something billion pounds more than we expected through COVID, rightly, and inflation. But we've got to have, you know, a viewpoint about that context. I don't want house building to go in the place that, as has been suggested, but equally, you know, the job of politics is to, as you all know, is to try and marry infinite and very worthy propositions with very finite resources. And that's my job and the job of my colleagues, but it's something that we can't miss. Can I just give you the focus group of North East Derbyshire in the instance of the planning question, how you get people more bought into planning? And this is me speaking as a constituency MP rather than as a minister. In 2005, North East Derbyshire adopted a local plan, a population of 75,000, four towns on the outskirts of Chesterfield and Derbyshire. In 2010, it should have updated that local plan, some point between 2010 and 2012. The council decided it couldn't bother to do that. So North East Derbyshire drifted for the best part of a decade, having no local plan. In fact, the councillors weakening the rapidly outdated and ageing local plan so that developers could build outside of the settlement development limits that people recognise where the settlements ended. And then mucked about for the best part of a decade, where over 1,000 more houses were built speculatively, which shouldn't have been built in the places they were, and then couldn't put a plan in at the end of the day. And then got to a point in 2019 where the plan was still far too infantile for it to be considered. And then the inspector came along And despite the new council, conservative as it happens, but I'm not trying to make too much of a political point, but all these problems were under Labour, the new Conservative council, which was charged to fix the mess, came along and said, well, even though the previous council really mucked this up, even though the previous council loaded a number into that plan which was higher than was actually the objectively assessed need at the time, and even though we've managed to find all of those places so we don't need to build on Greenbelt, the inspector came along and forced the council to build on Greenbelt. So you will forgive some constituents, however much, and I'm sure many of them agree with the concept of building, as I do, of getting more houses out there, of having more people owning property, making sure that infrastructure is in place, and that's quite a lot of what I do most of the day. But you will understand the cynicism of people if local politicians have failed them consistently over more than a decade and have not had the kind of conversations that they need. And it's laziness in part, I'm afraid, and it's a failure and unwillingness to have hard decisions and have hard conversations early. I'm a massive advocate for local government. I'm a councillor of 8 years standing. It was where I started my journey into politics. But if councillors aren't willing to not just cut the ribbons, but also have the difficult conversations about what they want to do at a point when it is necessary, as opposed to when they're forced to put local plans in place, and then by the time people see planning applications go in and then try and object and they realise actually the principle has been seeded many years before, if local councils and councillors aren't willing to do that, it shouldn't be news to us that people get very cynical about the planning process, right? And I know that doesn't happen everywhere, but I can understand why my constituents are irritated about planning as a result of 15 years of bad leadership on the part of the Labour Council at the time.
Do the people in the new build housing feel like they've been failed?
Well,
statistically speaking, obviously you have a better idea about your own patch than I do, but you know, when you think about, I think about it from just looking at the BES data, right? Most of those people in new build housing will probably have voted for you. Most of them presumably don't hate their own homes and think they should be ripped up and thrown into the dust. So, yeah, do the residents feel they've been failed?
Well, a number of those residents have issues with snagging, but putting that one aside, because that's a temporal thing. The major response I get from the new build houses, particularly in the south of my constituency, is utter frustration with the lack of infrastructure which comes along with it. And I completely understand that, because when I became the MP in 2017, we have a massive congestion issue along our A road. We have no local transport links in terms of rail. I went and I said to the council at the time, OK, guys, what is the plan to sort out congestion? What is the plan to do something with regards to rebuilding a railway in one of the major towns? And the answer was nothing. They'd just written it in a document and done zero thinking about it since then. So we've been trying over 6.5 years to actually do all the work, the traffic surveys, the modelling, all the stuff which is really unsexy and needs to be done in the background over the best part of a decade. So you can even make the application to fix the infrastructure, but that takes years. So you can kind of get why they're very happy to have a house. I'm delighted they have a house, but if they can't get up the A road in the morning to get to work, that's just as much of a problem as the other one.
Jennie, let me bring you in on this.
Yeah, there's a few things there. I mean, the point about infrastructure, it can feel really very circular. But housing also has to implement the policies of government. So, you know, in the calculation of highway impact, it is the government policies around sustainable transport, lack of investment in public transport networks, the fact that if you build a road, people use it, and that's, you know, inherently unsustainable. I mean, one of the interesting ones that often comes up is GP surgeries. I have sites, in fact, you know, any other developers in this room probably have sites up and down the country where we have identified the place for GP surgeries. But the health department's strategy, stated strategy on healthcare, is not to promote single-handed and small surgeries, it's to deliver primary healthcare in very fantastic central locations with wonderful services. But that hasn't been properly communicated to the electorate. So it is the housing developer who is actually accused of delivering insufficient infrastructure. you know, I understand the frustration around local plans. I love local plans. Local plans deliver certainty. They deliver engagement with the community and an understanding of what's likely to happen in their local area. Therefore, it is imperative that local authorities undertake their local plans. Minister, your government has the tools through legislative means to make local authorities who are failing to bring forward their local plans do so, and you have not done so over that decade. We have 40% of this country now covered with up-to-date local plans. We can ensure a functioning planning system where we deliver more consistency. The National Planning Policy Framework was a wonderful tool to encourage local communities, local authorities to deliver their plans. We just left them to it for far too long. We should have been putting much more pressure on it. I will let you speak in a moment, Lee, but there was one there was one other point, actually, and it's around this sort of street votes and PD extensions, if I may, and it's, you know, it's a little bit tangential. Every time we extend a home that's more affordable, it becomes a home that's less affordable, which means that every time government extends permitted development rights, whether it's through street votes or other means, homes in the existing housing stock get bigger and bigger and less affordable. And therefore, whilst we are helping those who are in the housing stock who don't have the mobility to move around, and that is good, you do need to recognise the consequential impacts of affordability and affordability stress that then moves its way through the housing stock. That's why we need to continue to contribute new homes. And that is why, although the question around housing stats falling can be put to, you know, what else should we be saving money on? We can be saving money on the NHS bill because poor quality housing costs the NHS billions and billions of pounds a year. If we don't help support supply chain and some of, particularly the small house builders, and I see Brian in the room, then we will not have the capacity and the infrastructure to deliver the homes when demand returns, and that's, you know, that will be a failure of our generation.
I was just going to say, areas with local plans deliver more housing. So there is a halo effect here that if you put local plans in place, it tends to mean more housing comes at the end of it.
And Sam, on permitted development, are we kind of exacerbating an affordability crisis if we just kind of build up?
No. There's a really, really important point here. And John Byrne Murdoch, is that his surname? From the FT, has done fantastic work demonstrating that all new supply is good supply. And I think that there is there's some concern, you know, understandably, as I said, people concerned about sort of executive homes being added to the market or these new flats that are built that they won't be able to afford. I mean, yeah, a way to think about it is if you're building a new glass penthouse, that means that the millionaire who's buying that is not buying the terraced house. That means that that is then more affordable. All supply at all points in the chain are all valuable contributions and all help ease the housing crisis.
Okay, let's bring in some more questions because I know there are lots. I've got one over here. I'm going to go for one just back there, and then I'll go for one over here as well. So we'll do those three. So let's get a mic over there. Thank you. No, just over there at the front. On the right there.
Hi, Charles Fifield. I'm a chartered surveyor, and I just spent 12 years being a borough councillor, and I'm here on behalf of the Almshouse Association. During my experience as a councillor, one thing I noticed that was more important than anything else was whether or not you could get the community on your side in terms of proposed planning issues. And fundamentally from that, there were two good things that I learned from that you needed to do. New homes bonus, when it was there in our council in Cheshire West, we ring-fenced 20% of that to go to the town or parish council where the development took place. Now, town and parish councils are really important, but a lot of politicians haven't heard about them because they're not in Greater London, and therefore here be dragons outside. So if you can get those on your side, you're doing well. The other thing that we need is a slightly wider definition of affordable housing and community housing. Almshouses are not legally considered to be affordable housing, despite the fact that most licence fees that the residents pay are lower than an affordable rent and lower than the local housing allowance. But they're not legally affordable housing, which mm-hmm. is crazy. So I think it's got to be about getting the communities on their side. And I think parish and town councils, if, for example, the infrastructure levy, say you could designate ring fence 10% to those bodies, I think you might see a big increase in the amount of housing that goes on. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. Can heartily recommend the Onward report, Double Devo, all about parish and town councils and why they're important and why we should have more of them. Let's take a question from back there.
Good afternoon. Reverend Graham Hunter from Citizens UK. Citizens UK has been a long-term champion of community land trusts as a mechanism of locking in affordability for the long term. And I suppose the question is, what's the role of community-led housing projects in unlocking the housing supply and delivering more genuinely affordable homes in local contexts? And what are the barriers to that that need to be overcome, both in financing the community-led housing sector, but also reducing the cost of the planning system, which is so difficult for community-led projects to navigate?
Fantastic, thank you. And then a question right front row here on my left. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Lisa Hazeldine from The Spectator. My question is for the Minister, because we've been talking about unlocking housing supply, but the other side of supply is obviously demand. And I think particularly over the course of the past year or so, we've seen that quite acutely in the rental sector. Particularly, I think the role that estate agents can often play in this as well, sort of encouraging bidding wars and I think quite some quite unscrupulous practices from sort of people I've spoken to who've gone through that, you know, trying to rent somewhere in the past year. And a lot of the sort of areas of life that sort of quite vital, so, you know, so we've got the CMA, we've got Ofgem, Ofcom, all these sort of regulatory bodies. But there doesn't really seem to be anything like that for the rental sector and for estate agents in particular. So my question was if that's something that could be on the cards, you might be willing to think about, and particularly, you know, how that influences how these price bubbles begin to grow.
Thank you. So Charles on parish and town councils, Graham on CLTs and community-led housing, and Lisa on rogue estate agents in the rental sector. Jennie, let me come to you on this community-led housing question. So I'm curious, I mean, to what degree do you find things like community land trusts appealing? I know there are some models in which you can kind of meet your affordable housing obligation through things like a community land trust. How have you engaged with communities and looked at community-led housing projects?
Yeah, we do. I think that you know, the advice can be hard to find. It's not readily navigable by communities. How do you get to start? We do have some developments that are engaged with community land trusts, and where we're building development and then passing it, sort of bequeathing it to the communities so that either the income from the housing can then sort of be used to pay for some of the wider sort of community assets. So there is a variety of them. But I do think it's about increasing the visibility and awareness both across the industry and into communities that there's an opportunity. And developers, if we're bringing forward a development, we already have land, and so that removes one of the biggest barriers that we find for communities, which is they find it difficult to acquire the land and to start the process. And you know, the point about planning costs, then unfortunately they will suffer there's the same way as our SME builders, and indeed, you know, our businesses do. The planning system is really very complex and difficult to navigate, and it's extremely costly, and it's very hard to get any borrowings against planning risk, so it will only be capable of being funded other than from the community themselves after it's passed the planning the planning process. I think on the question around new homes bonus, we talked about incentives, you know, and incentives and sanctions, you know, to try and get that brave political decision that Stephen was talking about. I think it is worth noting that part of the SIL, the Community Infrastructure Levy, a proportion of the levy that's paid by a developer does go to the town or parish council, providing they have a neighbourhood plan in place. And it has resulted in some very good contributions to parish councils for investment in, you know, in their fixed assets and facilities. Occasionally, it has resulted in an embarrassment of riches for relatively small parish councils who really can't then invest the money. There's a little bit about a proportionality, but there is, if a neighbourhood plan is in place, there is a mechanism for benefits to flow through to the parish.
Stephen, can I come to you quickly on this question about renters that kind of came at the front? They're a group we haven't really talked about here. To what degree are they politically salient? Are they a group whose troubles we should be particularly concerned about from an electoral perspective?
Well, directly, no, right? They're not. then you know, ultimately, renters are not, have never been, and barring a very strange development in our political economy, are not going to become part of the Conservative electoral coalition. But because ultimately the economy is an ecosystem, right? Like the reasons why renters are having a terrible time are also why they're why that top up of mortgage holders than bolster the Conservative coalition don't exist. And one of the same thing that means that someone who's, you know, voted Conservative since 2010, who's benefited from low interest rates and is now, you know, for the first time basically ever in their professional life having to experience putting something, you know, taking something out of the shopping trolley and putting it back because they can't afford it anymore. That is why we're seeing these pressures in the rented sector. So it ultimately is all connected. I think, though, the other interesting question is, just from a policy perspective, what is the Conservative vision for renters, right? George Osborne had a lot of, you know, very developed ideas. He essentially wanted everyone who was an amateur landlord to exit the sector and for it to be the work of big businesses and organised landlords. Now, you can argue about the wisdom or lack thereof of that approach, but that clearly fitted into his overall sense of how the housing market needed to work. At the moment, because there are so many crises in the housing market, I think there's a problem for the government, and it's kind of like, oh God, there's a fire over here, there's a fire over there. But they are, of course, the same fire.
Lee, final word to you on any of those questions that you want to tackle.
Well, I probably should answer the estate agent's one as a former estate agent. I think you're aware the government introduced the Renters Reform Bill in July, and that's going to progress through Parliament over the course of the coming months ahead. So there is a recognition that there are changes that are needed here. There's obviously a big debate to be had about that. It will need to go through Parliament in order to do that. But notwithstanding Stephen's points about the political elements, I think the government recognises there is work to do on that. I think I'm not... It would be Rachel who would be... who's this is the purview of, so I will hesitate to transgress into her area, but this is an area that's looked at in terms of estate agents on a fairly regular basis every few years. The challenge with it all is always not whether there is poor behaviour in the sector, not whether there is problems, not whether I've rented longer than I've been an owner-occupier, so I remember problems myself. It is simply that we, for those of us in the room who are of the conservative disposition, the question on all of those things always have to be, is it of a sufficient magnitude to do something? And does the system work well enough to mean that that is not necessarily the case? Because if we cannot regulate in every single place, and I'm not speaking specifically about estate agency, I've been out of it far too long to understand whether it's good, bad or indifferent, but and my last experience is trying to buy a house was not a positive one with an estate agent. But the question for us all that we have to stand back on is, what is the place of regulation and how far does it extend? Because everything's okay in isolation. In aggregate, it gets problematic.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Lee. We're going to have to leave it there. Three quick thank yous. One to Taylor Wimpey for supporting this panel and facilitating a discussion on a topic that's really close to Onward's heart. Secondly, to all of you for coming along. You do not leave the Onward marquee empty-handed. We have these fantastic water bottles that we'd love you to take. We practice what we preach. They are fully sustainable and aligned to our net zero programme, and please do take them. We've got absolutely tons to shift. And finally, a massive thank you to our panel, to Stephen, Sam, Lee and Jennie, please give him a round of applause. Thank you.